Welcome to Holy Week. It wouldn't be a holy week in the life of the church without lots happening and breaking. So we come to this service very much in the full humility of knowing that we are not in control, and also knowing that we will still meet God. And we hope that that is space that you all will encounter as well in all of the battles that you are fighting and whatever is happening in your worlds right now. We come with all of who we are to meet all of who God is. And it is a God who sees us, who hears us, who knows us, and who has come to deliver us. And so this night, we stand with God as God called out through the burning bush to Moses. And we stand this night as God called out to us through Christ. And we stand this night as a church who has given witness to the redeeming and the saving work of God over and over and over again. And thank goodness for it, because we need it now as ever. So may this be our moment where we take a deep breath and give space for everything else to fall away so that we can hear the words, the story of our salvation.
Would you please rise and join me in the call to worship? This is a night to remember.
We remember when Jesus gathered
in an upper room and washed his disciples' feet. We remember the new commandment Jesus gave, that we are to love one another as he has loved us. Remember the new covenant, broken bread, and poured cup. We remember Jesus' night alone in the garden, in prayer. Remember this night, give thanks to God for Christ's steadfast and abiding love. Amen. Please be seated.
Disciple, will you serve as I serve? The Gospel according to John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17. Before the festival of Passover, Jesus knew that his time had come to leave this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them fully. Jesus and his disciples were sharing the evening meal. The devil had already provoked Judas, Simon Iscariot's son, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew the Father had given everything into his hands and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the table and he took off his robes, picked up a linen towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a wash basin and began to wash the disciples' feet. Drying them with the towel he was wearing. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" And Jesus replied, "You don't understand what I'm doing now, but you will understand later." "No," said Peter, "you will never wash my feet." And Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't have a place with me." So Simon Peter said, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." And Jesus responded, Those who have bathed need only to have their feet washed, because they are completely clean. You disciples are clean, but not every one of you. He knew who would betray him, and that's why he said, "Not every one of you is clean." After he washed the disciples' feet, he put on his robes and returned to his place at the table. He said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you speak correctly because I am. If I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you too must wash each other's feet. I have given you an example. Just as I have done, you also must do. I assure you, servants aren't greater than their master, nor are those who are sent greater than the one who sent them. Since you know these things, you will be happy if you do them." And while we sing the hymn of reflection, we invite you to have your feet washed at the two stations in the front of the corners of the sanctuary.
Disciple, will you remember me? The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 22, verses 13 to 20. Oh, I'm sorry.
Foot washing is one of the great symbols for deacons around the world. It reminds us of the water that Jesus used to wash the feet, but more importantly, it reminds us of the service that Jesus performed for his disciples, but more importantly, taught us about what it means to be a disciple and to follow Christ. These two things, the basin and the pitcher were given to me by this church when I was ordained. And they've been symbols for me as well as tools for me to use in ministry since then, and a reminder of what my service is here at the church as a deacon here at Epworth United Methodist Church. But the importance of this is the lesson that's taught. A lot of times when we listen to the Last Supper scripture, we sometimes have a tendency to miss this really important piece that's shared in the Gospel of John. This part in which Jesus takes off his robes, ties a towel around his waist, and goes around to each of the disciples and washes their feet. Now, one thing that we know of customs at the time, whenever there was a meal, a servant would take on the role of washing the feet of every person that was gathered there for the meal. So when Jesus assumed this role, all the disciples who looked up to him, who saw him as not only their teacher, but their Lord, were completely offended. They were very upset that Jesus would take on this piece. If we look at the Gospel of Luke, one of the things that we notice in there are the disciples having quarrels at the table. They were quarreling as to who was more important, who was less important, who should sit next to Jesus, who shouldn't sit next to Jesus. So while it doesn't mention this in the Gospel of John, I have this just vision of Jesus coming into the meal and hearing this quarreling and realizing that he needed to offer a very important lesson to each and every one of the disciples to remind them what it means to follow Christ, what it means to be a servant. There's some important words to remember in what he said. He asked them, "Do you know what I've done for you? Do you know what I've done for you?" So taking them from a moment ago, complaining about who got to sit next to Jesus and who got to do this, that, and the other thing, and who was going to be at Jesus' right side in heaven and everything else, all of a sudden they're having to think about, what did Jesus just do? Peter, we know, was very upset about Jesus going to wash his feet, right? You'll never wash my feet. You can't do that. Maybe Peter was realizing in that moment the mistake that he and the other disciples had made. Realized that Jesus was assuming a role that they should have assumed. Maybe he was thinking that Jesus was doing it as a way to punish them for not taking the time to think about it for themselves. But I really think what it was a lesson, not just for the disciples, but for every single one of us. Do you know what I've done for you? God humbled himself, came down as a baby at Christmas. God continued to go forth and to teach and to heal and to share meals with those that you weren't supposed to share meals with. He went around people that were unclean. He did all these things because God was showing us something new. God isn't about ruling over us. God is about loving us. Creation happened because God wanted to be in relationship with us. And Jesus was showing that as a disciple, you're going to be known by your love. And part of your love in following God is how you serve others. And then he said, I have given you this as an example. Just as I have done, you also must do. So I ask you all, as you observed or participated in the foot washing this evening, think about what was it that Jesus did? What is it that Jesus is asking us to do? And how can we find ways where we take off our robe of importance, our robe of thinking that maybe we're a little bit better than others, our robe so that we are humble and find ways of serving others regardless of their stance or their place in life or who they are, but we find ways of sharing God's love with everyone. Pray on that as we approach this weekend.
Disciple, will you remember me? The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 22, verses 13 to 20. The disciples went and found everything just as Jesus had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When the time came, Jesus took his place at the table, and the apostles joined him. He said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I tell you, I won't eat it until it is fulfilled in God's kingdom. After taking a cup and giving thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. I tell you that from now on, I won't drink from the fruit of the vine until God's kingdom has come. After taking the bread and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup after the meal and said, this cup is the new covenant by my blood, which is poured out for you.
When the time was right, God sent Jesus to be among us.
Born into this life, seeing God's grace revealed in all things, he laughed with those who laughed and mourned with those who mourned.
Through God's love, he healed the sick, he welcomed the outcasts, he challenged those in power and the structures that kept them there.
And he called us back to God's love.
In the power of the Holy Spirit, the Christ laughs and cries, heals and welcomes, challenges and loves again and again and again.
In response, some shout Hosanna.
Some shout Crucify.
Some shout Jesus.
Some shout Barabbas.
Some wave palms.
Some shake their fists.
Some break bread.
Some break silence.
Some proclaim Jesus.
Some deny Jesus.
Some carry the cross.
Some run from the cross.
Some are angry.
Some rejoice.
Some anoint with costly perfume.
Some complain at the waste.
Some like the light.
Some prefer the shadows.
Some weep.
Some conspire.
Some follow.
Some hide.
Some believe.
Some betray.
God, help us to choose you to shout for life.
To follow the cross.
To break bread.
To hold belief.
To trust love.
And tell the world.
We choose to follow Jesus.
When Jesus poured the wine and the bread was broken, his company at the table included the betrayer and the friend, the wrongdoer and the wrongly done by. It would not have been God's table without them.
It would not have been God's table if they hadn't all been gathered around it.
When Jesus poured the wine and the bread was broken, when everyone could eat, the outcast and the beloved, the arrogant and the gracious, the wrongdoer and the wrongly done by.
The table became a foretaste, a love made real, and of a world made whole.
On their own, the bread and wine are nothing. To become a foretaste and a promise of love made real and a world made whole, they need a story and a blessing and a people who believe.
And the promise is that when we are together, when we tell the story and give the blessing, when we break the bread and pour the wine, we will discover a foretaste of love made real and a world made whole.
And so we ask in all expectancy and in all humility, that God, you pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, so that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Make us one with you, one with one another, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet.
It takes faith to wait without hope, to trust that although there is no sense to this, we must do it anyway.
At the limits of our capacity to make sense of the world, at the edges of our grace, energy, and love, lie this.
Bread and wine.
So take and eat.
If nothing else, it will keep us alive.
As children together, would you join in praying the prayer that Jesus taught us? Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
We serve a Savior who is whole, but who chose to become broken, so that we who are broken might be made whole. A Savior who is full, but who chose to empty himself, so that we who are empty may be filled. May we remember Christ and what Christ has done, is doing, and will do for us this night. We will serve communion around the rail this evening. The loaves are all gluten-free. So as the ushers lead us, may we come and gather at the table.
Thank you.
Disciple, will you pray with me? The Gospel according to Luke, chapter 22, verses 39 to 46. Jesus left and made his way to the Mount of Olives, as was his custom, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived, he said to them, "Pray that you won't give in to temptation." He withdrew from them about a stone's throw, knelt down and prayed. He said, "Father, if it's your will, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not my will, but your will must be done." Then a heavenly angel appeared to him and strengthened him. He was in anguish and prayed even more earnestly. His sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he got up from praying, he went to the disciples. He found them asleep, overcome by grief. He said to them, "Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray so that you won't give in to temptation."
We gather and we remember a dark night. Everyone in this world will have their own dark night. If we haven't yet, at some point in our life, life will break beyond what we can hold. And there will be no place to go but to our knees, most likely with tears. I think that we can find comfort that Christ was there too. And I think that we can find direction and how Christ lived his ministry and how he gave himself to kingdom work. One of my favorite things in Luke's gospel are those little snippets that you miss if you're not paying attention of Jesus going to a secluded place or not to pray. For as many of the stories of healings and the teachings and the moments that we have in this gospel interwoven through all of them, are Jesus leaving and praying. And there is no greater directive for us, no greater advice or guidance for how to make it through our battles and life as it comes than to weave prayer into every aspect, every time, to surround it with every bookend that we can, to go by ourselves, to make space and time to go and be there and pray so that we can be fully honest about where we are, not having to worry about how it will affect anyone else, and not falling into the temptation ourselves and praying in such a way to impress others, but to let the full spectrum of our experience and who we are be present before God's. I think that we fall into two different extremes in how we pray often, and asking God for healing and for wholeness now in the way that we are conceiving of it. And if we only share this point without asking, as Christ does, for God's will, acknowledging that what we want might not be what God has planned for us, then we can really easily view God as a power source that we can control and flip on and off when we want. But on the other side of that is not ever asking for what we want or we think we need because we might offend God or because God's too busy with other needs that are greater. And then we miss out on putting all of who we are on the altar before God, and we miss knowing all of who God is and all of God's love and care that can redeem and strengthen us and our lives. And so this night we join with Jesus, and we join in those dark nights where we pray, "God, take this cup from me." And where we sweat to the point our tears and our sweat becomes like blood falling from us because of how much it means and how strong the storm is inside of us. But even then, we follow a Christ who gives room for God to work. Not my will, but yours. One of the hardest questions for me and this night, as one who loves communion so much, is what does it mean that those who partake of the body and blood of Jesus in the most intimate community act are willing to abandon and betray one another just a few hours later? We just held hands around that altar. I don't think it was dissimilar from the time the disciples were gathering together. One of the reasons prayer is so important is because it prepares us and it centers us and it anchors us. The angel didn't save Jesus, but he did strengthen Jesus. And without that strengthening, the disciples fled. Or there's even Peter who pulled out his sword and tried to start a revolution right then and there and hacked off the ear of one of the servants of the guards. But Jesus, in prayer, in the strengthening he received from God, was able to meet his betrayer and his arresters in a calm conviction of a power that did not come from him, but came from God, and was able to hold through all of that and what was coming in a prophetic witness that endured to the bitter end. The end might not change. The betrayals and the abandonment might not change. But how we are able to meet them and how we are able to witness in the midst of them does change. And that is the gift of prayer, of Emmanuel, God with us. Facing a battle tonight and would like specific prayer with Bill or myself, we have anointing oil with us, and feel free to spend time at the rail.
Shame, abide with me.
Eternity will weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me. I will weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me. Eternity will weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me. Will weep no more and sing for joy. Abide with me. Disciple, will you love one another as I have loved you? The Gospel according to John, chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. I give you a new commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, so you must love each other. This is how everyone will know that you are my disciples, when you love each other.